Good morning, everybody. Happy Valentine's Day.
Oh, happy Valentine's Day.
I want to thank my esteemed colleague, Russ, for taking over for me last Sunday while I took a week's vacation where I could just lay around and be waiting on hand and foot. Anything I wanted, my problem is day and night, they kept getting under my skin. So I'm glad to be back. Feeling a lot better, too. You know, it's interesting. In a church today, we celebrate the transfiguration of Christ. The world outside, however, it's known as Valentine's Day. Transfiguration is far more important of the two. So I hope all you men in the church have remembered it's Valentine's Day and done your duty. If you haven't, blessings be upon you. Today marks celebration of Valentinus of Rome, St. Valentine, as we call him. St. Valentine was a physician, a member of the clergy, during the time of the Roman Empire. We know him as a patron saint of love and marriage. He was best known for his ministry to persecuted Christians, allowing them to marry in secret after Emperor Claudius banned marriages to encourage men to enlist in the military and fight in battle. But Valentine is also known as a healer and comforter to the sick, those ill from plague, fainting, epilepsy, and other disorders. He was killed and martyred on February 14th of 270 at the age of 44, just a few thousand years ago. But one interesting story about Valentinus had to do with healing an aristocrat's daughter while he was in custody after his arrest. Father Valentinus told the jailer Asterius how Christ led pagans out of the shadow of darkness into the light of truth and salvation. So Asterius told him, if you could heal my foster daughter from her blindness, he would convert. Well, Father Valentinus covered the girl's eyes with his hands and said, Lord Jesus Christ, enlighten your handmaiden, because you are God, the true light. At that, the child regained her sight. Asterius and his family were baptized according to the agreement. When the emperor heard of the news, he ordered the execution of all of them. Love always has been a two-edged sword, especially Christian love. All of you who have been in a relationship know that love is a risky situation. But even more risky than romantic love is what Christians call agape love. Love for brotherhood and sisterhood. Human bonded love for each other that rises above all disagreements, differences, politics, and even illness. Love that rises above fear. For fear is always nearly the source of division between people. Fear drives quests for power and prestige, status and competition. Fear drives avoidance and bias of people who are different from those we normally deal with. Fear drives people to treat others with disdain, a fear of loss, a fear of change, fear of others through envy, jealousy, or ego are almost always responsible for our inability to love on a universal and deeply human need and basis. But as Jesus showed us from his own ministry, love, true love, comes from God. If we want to be lovers of humanity, we must first be in love with God. Allowing God to shine God's love through us. That is the ultimate emotional and spiritual risk. For it involves letting go of our own control, even our own conceptions of who God is, and our ability to make our own way and create our own joy.
Bob, we just want to touch this back on.
Okay. I'm going to pick her up later in the service. You'll figure out, you'll find out where. Excellent time. Great. She fits right in with what we're saying, so glad to have you back, Sammy. We need to allow God in. As Valentinus exemplified in his healing, We need to allow Jesus to shine as holy light into our lives and our hearts, so our very souls are transfigured into a vehicle and a beacon of His light and His hope. To be the hands and feet of God. To be Christian healers and disciples and apostles in a world of pain. A world that struggles to love. Especially right now, as you look around what's happening in our country. We need to pull ourselves back. Allow Jesus instead to shine. This morning we're going to a mountaintop with three of Jesus' disciples, where they had an unforgettable experience. You all probably know the story by heart. There was an author that's unknown that talked about a mountaintop experience that was unforgettable for one young man. How many of you ever mountain climbed? Well, I haven't. I've looked at them, they're gorgeous, but I've not climbed them. But a group of mountain climbers set out to conquer a high mountain. And one of their number was a beginning climber. This was his first climb. The climb was a strenuous one, but at last they reached a small plateau at the top of the mountain. And once it was clear that the beginning climber was at the very top, he stood up with his arms raised and yelled victoriously, "I did it!" At that point, a strong gust of wind nearly blew him off the mountaintop. The more experienced climbers got a big laugh out of it. Then they explained to him that when you get to the top of a mountain, you never stand straight up. But rather you drop to your knees to avoid being blown off the mountaintop. That's a good lesson when it comes to mountaintop experiences. First go to your knees. This morning we're going to deal with history's most dramatic mountaintop experience. One that was quite literally drove the three of Jesus' disciples to their knees. So to begin at chapter 9, as Steve read, when Jesus called his inner circle, his close friends, Peter, James, and John, to go with him up to the mountaintop, they were ready to go. Perhaps they thought in the ratified air of the mountain, their minds would clear. The Bible says on the mountaintop, in the presence of the three disciples, Jesus was transfigured. A word from original Greek, metamorpho, which is related to our metamorphosis, and means to change form. Christ's face became bright as the sun, according to Matthew 17:2, and his clothes were dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach, according to Mark 9:3. Then a cloud came over Jesus, who was speaking to Elijah and Moses, and a voice of God spoke to all, saying, "This is my Son, the Beloved, listen to it." That voice came down from the cloud for us as much as it came down for Peter, James, and John. "This is my beloved Son, whom I love. Listen to him." There was no way the disciples could have prepared what took place on that mountaintop, high above the ground. The disciples' hearts must have been pounding as fast as mine was last Sunday morning. Their minds must have been reeling from the experience. Imagine the intensity of that experience, the magnitude, the divine brilliance, the breathtaking light, the mystery, and the joy of what they experienced. On that mountaintop, they experienced a vision of God, of divine presence, power they would never forget. And it changed them. And it would transfigure their own hearts and their ministry to come. As if this weren't enough, the disciples saw Jesus talking with Moses and Elijah, both of whom had been dead for hundreds of years. Moses, you recall, gave the people of Israel 10 commandments and led them to the promised land. And remember, too, he himself went up the mountain to receive those 10 commandments and came down having been in the presence of God. And his face mysteriously shone so much, reflecting the glory of God, that he had to wear a veil. He was transfigured. His face was so radiant that people were afraid to come near him. Moses would then experience death in a manner designed by God. He was buried in the land of Moab, and no one knows where. Elijah, the first prophet of Israel, and his death was taken up to heaven in a chariot of fire. These two men represented the law and the prophets, the source of authority in Jewish life. And here the disciples were permitted to see the authentication of the announcement of Jesus, which he had been making. He had said, despite rejection, suffering, and death, he was indeed the Son of God who would rise from the dead. And here they were given a glimpse of that future glory. The multitudes had viewed Jesus as a prophet, like unto Moses, or as a new Elijah. Here, however, these two figures appear to pay homage to Jesus and to indicate clearly that he was not the forerunner for who would die a martyr's death, but he was the Messiah who would die a death of glory. And thus, in the agonizing days that lay ahead, the disciples were able to find renewed strength in the memory that God had already vindicated the sacrifice of his Son. Even if but for a moment, they had been permitted to see the end from the beginning. Then Jesus talked to Peter, James, and John. The cloud overshadowed their fear and embarrassment. The voice acclaimed Jesus as God's Son. They were not to be anxious about Elijah and Moses. They were to hear Jesus only. Jesus dealt patiently with their misunderstanding. He understood their reluctance to accept his suffering and death. He knew that they would like to preserve his presence and his power. What a magnificent event this event of the Transfiguration was. And only Peter, James, and John were privy to it. We know why this honor was accorded only to them, unless the answer is found in the last verse of Mark's account. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus gave them orders not to tell anyone what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. Now imagine what would happen if he had not given them that order, so to speak. How many of you would have kept an experience like this to yourself? I can picture, hey, y'all knew it, I saw a man. Your cell phone's been going wild with text messages. You couldn't have kept it to yourself. But Jesus says, don't tell anyone until I rise from the dead. A new era is on the horizon. A new dawn is about to break. And the old covenant represented by Moses and Elijah is passing away. And a new covenant is coming through the death and resurrection of Jesus. This would be when the time when they could tell everyone. But the time wasn't ready yet. Jesus' disciples still had work to do. That's why they couldn't stay on the mountain. You know, there's a strong connection that flourishes at first in the clouds. Our love for Jesus, too, is fed and flourishes first in the divine cloud of mystery, of faith, of the transfiguring grace. On that mountain, they experienced a vision of God, of divine presence and power that they would never forget. It changed them. It would transfigure their own hearts, and ministry would come. After that experience, they came down the mountain and engaged in ministry and mission, even more convinced that what they were doing was infused with the love and power of God, even as Jesus was God beside them and among them. You know, we don't stay on mountains. We don't stay in the clouds. But Jesus does stay with us and beside us as we go out to minister to real people with real problems in real places today. Christian love is a transfiguring love. The love of Jesus, the sacrificial grace of Jesus, changes us in ways that are powerful and intrinsic. We become spiritually strong. We become loving and healing vehicles of Jesus' salvation, His grace. As disciples, we're all meant to be healers, lovers of God's people, and holy physicians of God's salvation promise. We comfort the ill, we feed the hungry, we befriend the lonely, we invite those different from ourselves. We love the unlovable. For when we do, Jesus' transfiguring grace transfigures them too. In a shimmering hot sun were beautiful. They made the climb more difficult. The sweat trickled down his back and into his eyes. The bag he carried on the climb was becoming a great hardship. In fact, his weight forced him to stop. He could climb no further. Overwhelmed with the task, the weary traveler placed his baggage aside and rested. After easing the baggage to the ground, he rested against the side of a tree, allowing the cool and refreshing breeze to blow over him. He heard a bird singing above him. When he looked up, he saw the summit, his goal in the distance. He was somewhat renewed, he stood erect and, leaving behind his baggage, continued his climb. As he climbed step by step, the summit grew closer until he finally reached that goal. He looked about at the panorama before him. The scene was spectacular. He could see the verdant valleys, majestic streams, a powerful river, and fertile meadows and fields. Infused with this glorious view, he hurried down the peak to a level where he had left his baggage. He wanted to collect his belongings and return home. However, to his surprise, the things were strewn across the path in several boxes and a large backpack, an overstuffed briefcase. He looked in that first box, which contained all his memories, things like awards, report cards from school, and a few sports trophies. No longer sensing a need to reply or to rely on his memories, he put that box aside. In his great surprise, he felt taller and better. Next, it was a large backpack which contained all the beauty he had collected along his journey, some beautiful rocks, a photograph of a beautiful rainbow, and of course, many books from which he had come to know the beauty of the world. These things too he put aside, remembering the beauty he had seen from the mountaintop. Again, he felt a spurt of growth and freedom. Next, he examined the briefcase. It was full of various causes and concerns, issues and initiatives that had inflamed his spirit and passion his actions. Now, for some reason, these things seemed less important. The overstuffed briefcase was thus placed with the other discarded items. He then examined the rest of his baggage and realized that most of it was no longer needed, save for a small backpack, which removed from the discarded items. The excess baggage he buried in a deep hole along the mountainside. Now, aware of being rejuvenated, the climber slung that small pack over his shoulder. It contained a hammer, a saw, and a few other tools, and a bamboo flute. Again, the man ascended to the peak with a spring in his stride. He gazed back at the trail toward all the time-worn baggage he had carried for so long. And turning back, the climber looked toward the valley below and realized his journey had ended. Now renewed in spirit, over the cool breezes back, the climber grabbed the flute. And while playing a merry tune, he walked into the valley of his future. It took time and the realization that the burden of life is too heavy for that climber to see the need to change, to drop the past and move into a new future. What, however, happened to the apostles, Peter, James, and John? They were transformed internally and permanently to a new relationship with God. The transfiguration of our Lord and its ability to transform the apostles challenged us to see our need to change, to drop the past, to look to the brightness of the future. Transfiguration was certainly a particularly important event, as it is one of the only, one of very few things that are related to all three synoptics. The missive may say it is that Jesus' disciples must learn to change, adapt, drop the past and look to the future. Rather than concentrate on what happened to the Lord, the event is best understood by centering on what befell the apostles. Jesus' transfiguration prefigures what we shall someday be if we give our lives to Him. We live our lives transformed to something beautiful and radiant. As someone has said, nature forms us, sin deforms us, the penitentiary reforms us, education informs us, the world conforms us, but only Jesus transforms us. This is what the beautiful song, Beautiful, Beautiful, that Samuel hopes is going to sing now, is all about. How God can transform a person from the inside out. Samuel.
Beautiful.
the message? That you've been set free? Have you gotten the message that you can be transformed? That's what Sammy sung about. Listen to him. Whoever comes to me, I will never drive away, he says. He's talking about you and me. Listen to him. Whoever you are, or whatever you've done, transformation is possible. Listen to him. We're not called to remain in the same state that God found us, but to feed on his word and grow. Let him transform you today. Amen.